USA! USA!
Being a man is almost frowned upon.
There's a sense, I think, among a lot of men that the pendulum has swung a little bit too far in the opposite direction.
This idea that men get paid more than women is a lie.
The World Economic Forum currently ranks Iceland as the best place in the world when it comes to gender equality. Now, Australia, by comparison, well, we're ranked number 35.
It was really a strike in 1975, both on the labour market and in the home, which put Icelandic women on the world map. In the evening, there was a smell of burnt meat. The men were trying to cook.
Have you burnt the meat?
Harakaf.
Now, apparently the boys have had their nails done last week, so they just need a touch-up.
We cannot put children in a box, yeah. And then when they are 20, then you will say all of a sudden, be creative.
In Iceland, the pay gap is around about that 5% mark. In Australia, the pay difference is 15 to 20%. And yet you're still saying, still not good enough.
No, of course it's not good enough unless, until it's zero.
Floating into the air, melancholic harmonies of an ancient Viking song.
Iceland has been named the best place in the world to be a woman. Is it the best place in the world to be a man?
Yeah, we have a very strong woman, yeah. Independent, yeah. And we like it.
Well, strong women, that means also strong men, so I think the equality is the main point here.
I'm doing the same work as a woman, and a woman is doing the same work as me. Of course we should be paid exactly the same.
There is no other option than equality.
Agree? We very much agree when we take a bath together.
Hearing that having strong women means strong men is something I want to learn more about. The youngest choir member invites me home to the family farm.
Yeah. They're all beautiful.
Yeah.
They're five gators.
Hrannar and his dad are close. When he was young, he spent a lot of time with his dad because it was mum that went away to work to support the family farm.
Sko, þegar ég átti hann, þá var ég náttúrulega bara með búskapinn, sko.
Yeah. Well, like, I'm the last one. So when he had me, he was only working here as a farmer. So I was at home with him until I was five. I was all alone just here with him always. He was just always taking care of me and my mom was working away.
That's maybe a way he got sick of me.
So gender equality, women's rights, supporting women professionally, that sounds like it's been around for at least a couple of generations.
Ég veit ekki hvað þetta nokkra kynslóðir.
það ekki þín kynslu svona fyrsta?
Jó, ég myndi halda það. Mín kynslu væri svo fyrsta.
Og enda því hefði verið frekar bara...
Já, pappi sko bara, kona átti ekki að fara burtu sko.
Ah, okay.
Hún átti bara elda.
I think he thinks that his generation is the first one that came, like, wants that equality and everybody to have the same thing for everybody.
How does he feel about some people in Australia still believing like his father and grandfather did that women should be in the kitchen and nothing else?
Mér finnst það bara merkilegt. Ég held að þetta væri...
Merkilegt?
Já, ég veit ekki, mér finnst, ég held að þetta væri komið svo miklu lengra alls staðar.
So, how did Iceland get further ahead? For the past four decades, they've had a series of women in the top job. In 1980, they voted in the world's first democratically elected female president, a single mum. In 2007, they elected a gay female prime minister, also a world first. The current prime minister, Katrin Jakobsdottir, is a fierce advocate for women's rights and a mother of three. But it wasn't just women in politics who brought about change. On October 24, 1975, 90% of Iceland's women took part in a strike. At the time, women earned 60% less than men. These were their complaints. Job ads for low-paid work usually specified that a woman would be required. It was commonly said that housework wasn't real work. When seeking a job, often gender mattered more than education or experience. Without women's work, the country stopped. This is the moment that formed Iceland as a modern feminist utopia. And Sigurdur Dunna, one of Iceland's leading feminists, was there.
It was really a tremendous atmosphere and a tremendous day, which put Icelandic women on the world map for the first time. It made international news. It was a strike, both on the labour market and in the home. I remember very well that in the evening, there was a smell of burnt meat in the streets. The men were trying to cook. And burnt meat always reminds me of this day in 1975.
Well, you can understand why we wanted to wait, you see, to see you cooking the meat tonight. So, have you burnt the meat?
It's almost cold. No, it's not burnt, it's looking good.
One of the reasons Iceland is at the top of the gender equality list could be the revolutionary private kindergartens. What they do is almost unusual. For part of the day, boys and girls are separated. So boys can do stereotypical girls' activities, and girls can do traditional boys' activities.
Verði sterkar eða sterkar?
Sterkar!
Glæsilegt.
It's all about unravelling gender stereotypes.
Oh my God, they are just beautiful. They are just beautiful. Shall we continue and see some more?
Margaret, who runs the school, shows me first how boys are encouraged to develop their emotions and girls are taught to be strong and independent. It's a helicopter parent's worst nightmare.
Oh my God, they're wonderful.
What about just
from a safety point of view.
That is also experience to tolerate a little pain.
Right.
We cannot put children in books. When they are 2 years old, they say, oh, don't get dirty, don't do this, don't do that. Yeah. And then when they are 20, then you will say all of a sudden, be creative, go out of the box, be daring.
Yeah. As the girls get dirty and smash nails, the boys prepare to paint theirs.
Good morning. Hello. What's happening here, Margaret?
We are training closeness, being close, being friends.
And touch.
And touching to just feel the emotions.
In Australian schools, it's quite frowned upon, I think, for teachers to touch the children too much.
I mean, it's all about touching them. Mm. Touching them, touching their hearts.
Now, apparently the boys have had their nails done last week, so they just need a touch-up this week. This little boy's requested something, a rainbow, so we'll use a few different colours.
They came all the same colour.
Okay. Good choice. Beautiful.
So we saw some of the boys getting their nails painted. You're really encouraging that emotional intelligence there, but does that mean that you're also repressing their masculinity?
It's simply teaching them that they can be beautiful. There is nothing in this world that is only for girls or women. There is nothing.
But isn't the current situation worldwide, there's very much this momentum behind the Me Too movement, right? Where men are being taught to be very sensitive about physical touch, aren't they, towards other people, especially women?
It's all about starting early.
Okay.
I mean, so they are able to touch, to show their feelings.
I have to ask Margaret how busting gender stereotypes will shape the kids when there are men who still feel their masculinity is being threatened.
We're always saying that they are not good enough.
Mm-hmm.
No. But in our single-sex settings, we are teaching our boys social qualities.
Yes.
And we are supporting their self-image of being wonderful, loving and caring and beautiful guys. I have often been asked, will it just be gay? Mm. That's a completely different thing. You know, just experience everything in life.
The keys are.
Close to 10% of parents are choosing to educate their preschoolers in Margaret's kindergartens.
Are you ready?
I meet one of the dads at pickup time, and he invites me home to meet the family. Brian is an American expat and stay-at-home dad for Eric, aged 4, and the baby. He's one of the many stay-at-home dads in the country.
Kiss a little bit.
Have you seen changes in little Eric?
Definitely. He's quite shy and more of an introvert. So it's helped him a lot to just see him blossom. It's good that boys are taught more tenderness and being more sensitive.
Absolutely.
And girls taking more space and being noisy and assertive. You can see, like, just with the Me Too movement, we need boys, just the stereotyping of what a man is. We need to break that and let them also just show their feelings and be themselves.
Brian, you've got a background from the US, moved to Iceland, so you're aware of different cultures. Are you at all concerned that too much time is spent teaching boys those stereotypically feminine characteristics and that might be at the expense of some masculine traits?
No, I don't think so at all. I mean, he's learning a lot of these things through school, which I'm not necessarily teaching him at home. And he's getting all of the other traditional masculine techniques and stereotypical things. And it's also exciting to see, you know, when you start combining these things, what sort of little child is going to, you know, come out the other end in 10, 15 years. So it is definitely something that is also changing within the culture that, you know, these stereotypical masculine roles for me to take the kids out, no one thinks twice. It's just that's what a dad is, does. That's what he's supposed to do. And when the culture thinks that way, you know, it's acceptable for me to do these things, you know, then we're starting to make progress, and then it's not a radical idea for us.
And do you think that some of those women's rights come at the expense of rights for men?
I don't think it's a competition at all. There's also trickle down for men as well. Like, I get a 3-month paternity leave to spend at home with the children, which is paid for partly by the government, which is not offered in other countries.
Brian gets paid 80% of his salary in one of the most generous paternity leave systems in the world. Australian dads are playing catch-up here, with just 14 days paternity leave offered at the minimum wage.
Here in Iceland, it's very much like, you know, you don't have meetings at 5 o'clock because everyone knows that at 4 o'clock you have to pick up the children from kindergarten.
No more monkeys jumping on the bed.
I'm getting to spend more time with my sons and learn and watch them grow, which, you know, you could argue, you know, you can't pay for that sort of thing.
The little meme. What does a meme say?
With Brian taking care of things at home, Ninya's able to go back to work after 3 months looking after the baby.
And it's good to just slowly get into the rhythm. Yeah. Like not jump into, like, into work and then you have a like bad feeling that you're leaving your kid behind.
Yeah, sure.
This is like slow
baby steps.
Exactly. Which is very good.
It's the kind of flexibility that has helped Iceland rocket to the top of the world rankings for gender equality.
This is my office, Icelandic Lamb.
Okay.
And my boss is here. I would like to introduce you to him. So, here is Svavar Haldursson.
Hello, Svavar.
How are you?
Good, I'm Janice. Lovely to meet you.
Oh, nice to meet you too.
It's not just about getting women back to work. It's also about paying them what they deserve. Iceland has recently made it illegal for firms with over 25 employees to pay men more than women for the same work. Another world first from this nation.
This is the domestic consumption, the export, and the tourism.
Even though Ninya's boss could face hefty fines if he doesn't comply, he supports the law which aims to erase the gender pay gap.
When they first started talking about some laws about equal pay, I thought it was a good idea, because in my opinion, it's the thing to do. And this is how we try to run our company. And I think overall, at least among younger executives, that was a very common opinion. People were happy about it.
What about the timing of all this? In 2008, Iceland was hit really badly by a financial crisis, and yet 10 years later, you're introducing what some would say are quite radical laws around pay equity.
I don't think laws to implement it is seen as radical to anybody. And if we think back to 2008, to the whole big financial crisis, all the banks and the big companies were run by men. So maybe it was the absence of women that was the bad thing.
Ninya takes me to meet one of her co-workers, who thinks Iceland still has a way to go.
This is Oddný, my colleague.
Hello, Oddný.
Hello.
Janice, hi. Nice to lovely meet you. To meet you. Mm-hmm. In Iceland, the pay gap is around about that 5% mark. Mm. In Australia, the pay difference is around about 15 to 20%. Mm. And yet you're still saying, with that around 5%, still not good enough.
No, of course it's not good enough until it's zero. Why should there be any gap?
Well, the government wants there to be pay parity by 2022. Is that achievable, or is that a little too close for that to happen? Is there enough time?
It's good to have a strong goal, and then we can push it a little further.
I have three boys, and we should not favor one over the other. And sometimes, in for a short period of time, we may have to support men in this area and women in this area to reach equality.
But does gender equality come at a cost? Can a feminist utopia produce a dark side? Iceland may top the World Economic Forum's list as the best place to be a woman, but it also has one of the highest rates of violence against women per capita in Europe.
Domestic violence is something that's always been there. And one of the reasons why we see that it seems to be growing in this country may be the anxiety that men are feeling, which can increase violence in the home.
We hear a lot about the powerful Viking heritage that Iceland has and the strength of its women while the Viking men were away. But the picture is a lot more complicated than that, isn't it?
Men in Iceland are experiencing like they are watching a football game, and they have been relatively confident that their team would win. Now the position is 3-4, and it's not quite sure if their team wins or the women's team. So they're very scared and very anxious, and that is where some of them fit in. We are quite clear about the fact that we still have quite a way to go.
Iceland knows it has a dark side and is doing something about it. This video is about sexual consent.
Just imagine instead of initiating sex, you're making them a cup of tea. You say, hey, would you like it?
They've flipped the laws here. Instead of the victim having to prove they said no, it's the accused who has to prove they received a yes. And without a yes, it could be considered rape.
But if you can understand how completely ludicrous it is to force people to have tea when they don't want tea, and you're able to understand when people don't want tea, then how hard is it to understand it when it comes to sex?
These classes are also about understanding the power dynamics of sex and relationships. I have a chat with four students about what they think of the new consent laws.
Like if you're going to have sex and stuff, you have to talk about it and like know what the other person wants. And because I think it's of course very awkward and like people maybe don't want to do it, but we have to do it. And it's good to know like that that's what like a good sex life is. Like you have to get a yes, you know. Yeah. And
a very firm yes.
Yeah, yes. Very firm, yeah.
A tiny bit of the session talked about pornography, and we know that some of the statistics are saying that for boys at least, they might be watching porn about once a week, so probably sometimes more for some guys. But how much is that putting pressure on young people, do you think?
As long as there's education about it not being real, which, well, I mean, I think we're fortunate to have had that sort of education beforehand. But I mean, with those sort of, with that lens, if you look at it with a filter, sort of, yeah. But if it's not there, then it's very damaging, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's like, you know, pornography and sex and like real life and Spider-Man.
So Iceland's known around the world as the best place in the world to be a woman. But I'm just wondering for you young men, where does that leave you?
Equality doesn't, it just elevates the other side. It doesn't really push us down, I don't think.
One thing that's apparent here in Iceland is that you're constantly at the mercy of the elements. The environment here is incredibly hostile, and yet the people are anything but. The men, women, and children that I've spoken to have a very strong sense of resilience. They all pitch in and get things done.
There's been a strong history of female leadership making it to the highest office. And the relatively small population means it's easier to galvanise people behind the strongest gender equality laws anywhere on earth. And that's good news for women and men.